So there are a few people I'd like to start off by thanking. The Bob Marshall Wilderness Foundation, of course, and the Northwest Montana Fire Lookout Association, especially Nancy Manning. Thank you. The Montana Wilderness Association and Spotted Bear District, my parents who came all the way over to hear me talk tonight, and Lowell Yeager and John Fraley. So, yes, I grew up on the east side of the mountains here. So you look out on the range every day if you live in this valley. You see this beautiful range of mountains. And I grew up just on the east side of them, always looking over and loving them and being part of them. My family has deep roots in Montana. We grew up as ranchers and farmers, and we love the mountains and we love the plains and we love every aspect of the landscape here. So the background of what I want to say tonight is how important that our public lands are for us as Montanans, and how much I want to celebrate them tonight. And I'm so glad that you are here in support of wilderness, and that we need to keep supporting that as we move forward in Montana and the rest of the country. So my experience as a lookout in the Bob Marshall Wilderness, I think, is a testament to this experience of the wild that we can have here in Montana and other places, but especially in Montana. It's amazing and it's powerful and it will change you. And I know that probably looking out at the crowd here tonight, seeing all of your very true faces smiling back at me, you already understand that. So I'm so pleased to be here in Montana, where I am from, where my family is from, with this sensation of the power of wilderness that we want to continue. We want that legacy to last. So thank you for being here so much. So to start, about my experience as a fire lookout, it goes back to when I met a fellow when I was working at the Isaac Walden Inn, and he is a packer for the Spotted Bear District and has been for some time. And we randomly met, and he's a lovely human being, and he said, well, there's this lookout in the Bob, and I know of it. And I said, I'd always wanted to be a lookout. And he said, well, I know this lookout. Let me introduce you to some people. And I said, okay. And then I met those people, and things progressed, and I got to spend time back there in the Bob. So I work for Spotted Bear District. So how many of you know where Spotted Bear is to start off with? Okay, so quite a few of you. Because I wanted to start off by locating where that is in a general sense. So I brought my map. Let me pull it out here. Okay, so this is the Bob Marshall Wilderness via map. This is one side of it, and this is the other side of it. It's a large span of land, and Jumbo Lookout, where I was stationed, is right, oh, thank you, Carol. is right smack dab, kind of in the middle. Here, where are we? There's Big Salmon Lake. There's Han. There's the Danaher. Oh, there we are. This is Jumbo Lookout right in the middle. So this is where I was stationed for 98 days. Thank you so much. Do you want to clap for Carol? So just to give you a sense of context, although it sounds like most of you have a sense of where Spotted Bear is, and then if you go 45 miles south of Spotted Bear Ranger Station, you get to Jumbo Lookout. So it's really in the heart of the Bob Marshall Wilderness. So to start, I wanted to tell you a little bit about my experience getting qualified as a Type 2 firefighter for the district. So I found myself at Spotted Bear Ranger Station with a bunch of very earthy looking folks, much like yourself. And this was around the beginning of June, and we went through a bunch of different extensive types of training. So we had bear training, you know, how you interact with a bear when you see it. And then we had this thing called guard school, where if you're going to be fighting fire, you go through this, and it's a week-long process, and it's very intensive. And it's no joke, I may be smiling in that photograph, but it's really not funny. One of the most interesting days for, I think, most of us who went through that experience is when we went out in the woods for the afternoon, and you're going along and everything is fine and you're digging fire line. And you know, that was important that season because in 2015, as you probably all remember, it was one of the most intensive fire seasons that we've had in a very long time. So it was kind of practice, but it was also with this notion that in very coming up very soon, we may be doing this because we're actually trying to stop the fire from burning our structures and getting out of control so that we can't have a handle on it. So there was this sensation that it was a really important part of the experience that we were having there at Spotted Bear. So we're digging fire line and we're digging fire line, and then all of a sudden they tell you, okay, drop everything. The fire's out of control, and now you have to run up here, and you have to deploy your fire shelter, and you have to get yourself safe, and then the fire will hopefully burn over, and that kind of thing. So they try to put you in a real situation, or have the real sensation of what it's like when that kind of experience might occur, okay? So it was fascinating, and it was intense, but it was also no joke. So went through guard school and got certified as a Type 2 ranger there at the district. Another one of my favorite things at Spotted Bear in general, as part of the fire crew for the Forest Service there, was the fact that we ate meals together, okay? So they have a cookhouse, and it's the McLean Cookhouse. So I'm sure, how many of you know Norman, who Norman McLean is, or you've heard the name at least? Okay, yes. So there's a cookhouse dedicated after him, and so every meal we would gather together and cook together and share our meals together and then move forward with our day, and that was just fascinating. So the whole of June then in 2015 was spent during with training and a lot of anticipation for what that fire season might hold for us for the season. And then finally, it was time for me to go up to the lookout, the jumbo. So this is a letter that I wrote to my parents, dated July 3rd, 2015. I'm sitting here in Jumbo Lookout, gazing north towards Big Prairie from my tower at 8,200 feet. It has been quite a journey to get here, let me tell you. 1 week ago today, I left Spotted Bear from Meadow Creek, hiking south along the South Fork of the Flathead River. I stayed in a U.S. Forest Service ranger cabin at Black Bear, about 10 miles south of where I'd started, on the first night in. The cabin was surprisingly well-stocked and neat, which was good because a couple of backpackers from Santa Barbara showed up hungry that night, so I let them sneak some of the rations. Left early the next morning south still to try to beat the heat. It was up to 100 degrees that day, and those 20 miles took me nearly 9 hours to complete. The trail was relatively flat, but there were creek crossings next to the South Fork going east all along the way. so I had to stop fairly frequently to ascertain safe routes across the water. The crossing at White River was notable. Water almost up to my waist, fairly swift, rocky, and totally exposed. I made it. And then immediately hiked a hill to White River Park with a couple inches of water in my boots. I was in good spirits at this juncture, though, because I figured I was past the hard part and almost to Big Prairie. Not to mention, I was hiking through an enormous stand of the most beautiful ponderosa pines that I have ever seen. You can't see Big Prairie until you are pretty much right upon it. And even then, the trails leading up to the station are wayward and misleading. Leading up to the station, blocked by sagebrush and terrain much like that on the Rocky Mountain front. I came straggling through the gate up to the building with a flag. It was the ranger station. Most nights at Big Prairie, there's a campfire. On Monday night, we were working on putting together an evening game of Capture the Flag right around 10:30 when we were getting the fire going. The next thing we knew, a thunder and lightning storm was upon us. And believe me, I pay attention to those kinds of things now. Anyway, we watched lightning striking the mountains around us, and suddenly a tree on a mountain west of us across the valley called Charlotte went up in flames. They call that torching in fire terms. So the station guard, Jeff, and I walked over to the ranger station, and I called in my first fire to Jim Flint over the radio. He said I should start hiking up to the lookout the next day, so I said I'd leave at 6 a.m., which I did. I was hiking fast towards Jumbo the next morning. We'd watched lightning hitting the ground the evening prior, so I knew there could very well be a fire burning somewhere by the time I got up to the lookout. The first 10 miles or so to get up here via Big Prairie are relatively flat, continuing alongside the windy South Fork. Then the South Fork basically ends and splits into Young's Creek to the west and Danaher Creek to the east. The trail to get to the lookout splits off the Danaher side, although Jumbo Mountain is basically directly south of the division of the South Fork. I hope you have a map for all this. The 4 to 5 miles of trail to the lookout off of Danaher are steep, and you really can't see much except for when the switchbacks traverse the more southerly side of the mountains leading up to Jumbo. I cried when I first saw the lookout. I figure that I started dreaming of it and imagining it about 6 months ago. So much planning and preparation and training and physical and emotional labor has already gone into this. So far, I've been familiarizing myself with the natural terrain as well as the lay of the lookout itself. It is beautiful. It is cozy. Finally, I've found solitude, and I am so happy. So I made it to the lookout after some months of thinking about it and training for it and preparing for it. So what does a lookout actually do? I get this question all the time, you know, like how do you spend your time while you're up there and what is it that you're actually doing? I think most of us how many of you have been to a lookout yourself? You've been up to a lookout? Okay, yeah. How many of you have spent time at a lookout? Okay, so you're pretty familiar. So you have a sense, but I get this question a lot. Like, what is it that you actually do while you're there? So let's go over that a little bit. So I call this the traditions. Probably like most lookouts, while I was there, it was pretty routinized, you know? Yeah, I had a very strict sense of what I was doing every day, and it would start in the morning when I woke up with the sun and making coffee and making breakfast and eating and sitting and looking out at the sky and checking for smoke. You're always, of course, constantly aware of what's trying to be constantly aware of what's going on in the landscape, because that's your job, is to look for that smoke and to have that kind of awareness. So that was a big part of the day. Another big, of course, important part of the day is taking the weather, right? So all of the lookouts from Canada down south, I think I was the furthest south that we were in the Bob, but up in the North Fork, we'd start there giving our weather every day at 10 a.m. And so, of course, you're reporting the humidity and you're reporting the wind, like what's going on with the wind, and did we get any rain or was there any lightning? So all of these important aspects of the landscape that would tell other people, especially the dispatch here in Kalispell and also at Spotted Bear District, what was going on with the landscape. So that was a really important thing to do every day. Other things that I did, and then most lookouts I think also do, I spent a lot of time reading. So I think that's a good pastime for those of us who are lookouts to be interested in and to have. So I tended to have some nonfiction going and some fiction going, and I was reading The New Yorkers from 2014, which I hadn't gone through. So yeah, all sorts of reading material just to keep your day kind of going and to have these different kinds of thoughts in your mind too. And then also you saw a photo of me with the Osborne firefighter. So have you heard of, you know about this Osborne firefighter? Yes, yeah. No, some of you do. So it was that picture with the round thing. Let's see if we can go back to it. That thing there, which was created by W.B. Osborne, I believe is his name. So basically, if you look at that machine, you can, it's centralized for every lookout. Most lookouts have them in them, and then you can use it to identify where a smoke is on the landscape, and it's called an azimuth, and basically that can, you can identify a specific angle of degree from where you are to identify where a fire is happening, and then you deliver that information to other people who then come in and try to maintain the fire to a certain degree as they will in the Forest Service. So that was another part of my job as the tradition of a fire lookout. So other things, you're looking at maps all the time, of course, because you're trying to understand the land itself and identify where things are. I listened to the radio a lot. So you saw that picture with the book there. So there's my books and there's my radio. So that was my company. That was my companion, is this radio, and listening to what's going on constantly. So that was a major part of the experience as well. So it was a very ritualized experience, daily, getting up at 7 with the sun and then doing all of these very specific things throughout the day, and then at night going to sleep with the moon and then getting up and doing the same thing again the next day. So, very ritualized in that regard. So, of course, with any kind of work, that you're going to have certain kinds of trials along the way as well. And I think that as a lookout, some of those are very typical to what we would experience also in our daily lives in any kind of work. But there were some aspects that were very unique to being a lookout. So we're gonna look at those next, and I call those the trials.
Hyundai Pop Quiz, which compact SUV offers a laundry list of available features, like a hand.
From your sleep, you dry your tears. Today we escape. We escape.
So I guess this is more of the hard part of the story. So we have the regular things that we're doing and the traditions that we're doing. And then there are some difficult moments that will occur. So I think at points, the notion that all that I had was all that I had right there, right? So I have food with me, or there's food that is there, but if I were to get really hungry, for example, and eat all of the food, you know, where is there more food? There's more food. To get more food, I would have to literally hike myself 17 miles north to Big Prairie Ranger Station. You know, so like it's a sense of, okay, like I have to be constantly aware of what I'm intaking into my body, because that is what is there. So I'm eating, but I'm also very consciously aware of how much that I am actually eating. So that's a much different feeling of food, I think, than we normally have in our modern society, right? So that was that feeling of sort of industriousness that I needed to be aware. Also, the isolation did set in at different points. So it was, I think that we can really romanticize this idea that being by ourselves in the woods is this wonderful experience, but at a certain point, it's sort of like, okay, like it's just me all the time. It's only me. And yeah, and who do I talk to? Like, who do I interact with? And it gets, that loneliness can be really heavy sometimes. So that was something I tend to like to be by myself, but there were points where I felt incredibly alone with the actuality being that I couldn't just go talk to somebody else when I wanted to, right? Like typically we live in our societies where if we feel that way, right, we can go out and we can go find a friend, or we can go to a restaurant and we can interact. But in that situation, that's just not a possibility. And so that reality was a reality, and it was really difficult at times. So that was definitely true. I think another aspect of the experience that was really difficult was a lot of the uncertainty because of the extensiveness of the fires for the season. So for example, over the course of that summer, we actually had to close down our wilderness at one point because the fires were so intensive and so out of control that, not out of control, that might not be the right way to put it, but they were so, they were happening in so many areas that there was major concern for the people who were back there, right? Like, how we need to keep everybody safe, and we need to know that people are going to be okay. And so people were being evacuated in different regards and through different routes. And so there was a lot of uncertainty about what was going to happen or what should happen. And as the fire lookout, you know, just sitting there at Jumbo Lookout, sort of out of the loop, but listening to everything going on the radio and thinking, well, what's gonna happen, or what should I do? And trying to be in tune with what's happening and to be helpful. But that uncertainty created a lot of anxiety for me up there by myself, for sure. And then I think just the, you see these beautiful photos. This one looks kind of eerie, but it kind of looks pretty. But if you're looking at that kind of thing all the time by yourself, or just the vastness of the sky and the landscape all the time, it's beautiful, but it can become, it's just you looking at the sky. And that's what you're doing. And it can be, and that's what you're doing all the time, all the time. It can just get a little bit overwhelming. It's sort of like, well, what do I do with this feeling? Or what do I do with this experience? Because I'm having it. But what is everybody else doing? I don't know. And so that's kind of weird. And so it, that was very difficult. And then another thing about that was towards the end of September, there was a family of bears, grizzlies. There was a sow and her two cubs. And I love bears, and I love seeing them, but it made my trips down to the pit toilet every day a little bit more interesting, because I knew that they were out there and that we were sharing the same space. And so I definitely had bear spray just to go to the bathroom, you know? And that's kind of a unique thing, and kind of an interesting kind of hardship that I have. So I wrote this poem called Empty Like Me, and this was based on an experience when a lightning storm came through, and I was watching it, and a tree torched on my mountain, on Jumbo Mountain. And I saw it, and it was right down the gully from where I was at. So I forgot to read you my one about goats, but maybe we'll have time. But this one's called Empty Like Me. I went in search of the tree that torched 50 feet downhill down the gully. It smelled like death, like the process of death. Everything died or was dying. I could not be sure what I had found. Everything was black. Nothing looked right as it had first. Everything died. I might be lost. Shimmering ahead in the ghost glow of smoke and brown and black, I walked. Skeletal arms and skeletal legs wrapped fervently in bright orange silk. The heat of the day, the heat of the wind. A water jug, a plastic one, still had its lid, a plastic one, all dried up, gone. Glowing up here 8,000 feet out in the sun, empty like me, empty like me, empty like me, empty like me. Putting the thing under my arm, I turned uphill, did not look back. So there are the traditions of being a lookout that are really lovely and beautiful, and the things that you do every day. And then there are certain kinds of trials that you experience as a lookout. And then of course, there are these certain beautiful kinds of triumphs that you also experience because you are out there in the woods, like seeing all of these things. And so let's move now and talk about some of those things, the triumphs, I call them. So obviously, or maybe not obviously, but I learned a lot from my experience in the woods. And I really feel that I learned things that I would not have learned if it had not been the kind of experience that it was, with the traditions, with the trials that I encountered. And then you start to think about it, and in the midst of the experience, you start to learn about everything that's going on around you and what you can take from that and how it can move you forward. But I also feel that a lot of that has been retrospective too. So going through my journals and my letters and like looking at what I was thinking and what I was feeling at that time, and then kind of reflecting on that and what it means. So for example, so I had, you know, the food that I had, and that was the food that I had. And I had that food, and that was enough, you know? That was all that I needed, and it was exactly right. So I learned, you have what you have, and that is what you need, and you can sit in that, and you're fine, you're okay. And I learned a lot about my own industriousness along those lines. So for example, you know, you're out in the woods and you're on some kind of adventure, and no, you all know this already, but you're on some adventure and you encounter all of these small and kind of larger obstacles, but you get through them somehow. Like you come up to a river, for example, and you're going along, and you come up to this river, and it's really fast, or it's really deep, and you can't see the way across, but you just wait for a minute, and you look a little bit further down, and you see, oh, there's a tree, like there's a log across just down the way, and if I just go down there, I can make it, right? So you learn, like, you learn to trust a little bit in the way that things go and the way that things come together and your own capacity to find that. So I think that deep trust was a big lesson that I learned out there. Another thing that was really has been really interesting for me, especially looking through my journals from that time, because I like to write, so I write every day, every morning, and I've been looking back at them over the last month, just getting ready to talk to you about the experience. And one thing I noticed was that I would write, you know, like, you catch these thoughts in your mind. I hope a lot of you write too, but like, you catch this thought in your mind and you just write it down. And then it's been so fascinating to see how a lot of those ideas or those thoughts that I caught at that time ended up like actualizing themselves, if that makes sense. So it's like, you have this notion, you're on this mountain and you have this idea, and then it kind of starts to happen actually in and of itself in this reality that we have and we call it. So I think the magic of that experience has been one of the most compelling things. So if you look up at this photo here, when I say listen to the magic, it's like, so this is Poems Across the Big Sky too, and edited by Lowell. And when I was back in the woods, I was at Big Prairie on one of my weekends, and I found the first version of this book, Poems Across the Big Sky, and it was published in 10 years ago. And I was reading through it, and I thought, I looked at some of the poets and the poetry, and I was like, wow, this is really good. This is amazing. I wonder what it would be like to get published in that kind of book, you know, or what it would take. And I was back in the woods back there. And then, what do you know, but I find myself in one of Lowell's poetry classes last spring. And I was writing about my experience in the Bob, and then, you know, they published one of my poems in this book. Like, what? Huh? How does that happen? So I think just that magic that is part of the aspect of being in the woods and feeling close to that inspiration or whatever you want to call it, but being there and being present to that, being very close to that, was just, it's the best. And I find it best when I myself am in the wilderness and I got to experience it there. Of course, I met some very colorful characters while I was back there as well. So you get people who come up and visit you at the lookout. And some of my first visitors were family members of trail crew members of the Spotted Bear District, and they were fantastic as well. And then there was this guy. I wonder if he's here. Is he? You know, I gotta see what I can say about him. But there's this guy I met, and he used to work, you know, kind of on Wall Street. And he got out of that line of work and he said, I'm coming to Montana and I'm gonna spend my time in the woods. And he spends most of his time in the Bob Marshall Wilderness. So he came up and saw me, and he brought me books, and we exchanged books. We had this whole interaction through literature, which happened with a lot of people that I encountered, but I loved that part of my experience as well, so that was definitely a triumph. So on my days off, which were very few that season, but I got a couple, so I tried to trek around the wilderness as much as possible just to try to understand it, right? So like I told you earlier, my family has these deep roots in Montana and in the Bob Marshall Wilderness proper itself. So understanding the land, spending time on it was really important to me. And I wanted to have that experience and sensation. So my days off, I would hike around and try to explore as much as possible and stay in the backcountry cabins and, of course, bathe by creek and do my laundry via creek as well when I felt like it was necessary. So I had one excursion that was a little bit intensive and also terrifying when I went from the lookout to Big Prairie and then up to north to the White River east and then back around. So it was a 2-day journey that lasted longer than it should have, but I wrote a poem about that called I Got to Use This Pen. So I'm gonna share that with you. I got to use this pen. Hiked 67 miles over two mountain passes. A grizz snarled loud, bolted off into the brush. It was across the White River, at least 10 feet tall, no joke. Slept in a mule shed, huddled between two bales of hay and three propane tanks. Listened to the flutes at Indian Point all night long. Really, all night. In the morning, pulled on two wet socks, stuck them in two wet boots, ate half of a granola bar the mice had left, got lost on Ahorn Creek. Got found on Ahorn Creek. Said hallelujah to the void. I once was lost, but then I got to Pearl Basin. Then I got to Jumbo Mountain. Then I got to use this pen. September 26th, 2015. Dear Ma and Pops, it is 20 minutes to 6 on a Saturday evening, late September. The wind was gusting even more so than usual earlier this afternoon, at least up to 30 mile an hour gusts. Smoke activity today was rather quiet, though, especially compared to yesterday, when a huge plume over in the Sealy Lake District started pushing hordes of smoke over into our valley. Another fire, the Lena Fire, in our district, got to pushing up smoke too. And a flight yesterday evening confirmed that the fire had finally reached the trail. This is not good, considering the fact that it is a well-used area. At the end of Gordon Creek, where it meets the South Fork, there's a big hunting camp run by the Chef family. I know this very particularly because I met a number of their packers and guides on my last backpacking trip, which was 90 miles from here to Big Salmon Lake, west and south and back to here. I was reluctant to come back up here this last time, in part because of the Grizz family, and in part because all the other lookouts have been down for weeks, except for Spotted Bear. It's a different kind of loneliness to know that there are only two of you within a million plus acres of forest living on the top of a mountain. But this just in, I am coming down on Tuesday. It has been a very challenging summer, and I am ready to emerge into modern day society. They have offered me the option of hiking out to Benchmark and being picked up. It would be 2 days less of hiking, but I kind of like the idea of finishing what and where I start. So, I wanted to have the whole experience, and I wanted to start from Spotted Bear Ranger Station and go all the way to Jumbo, and then come all the way from Jumbo back up to Spotted Bear Ranger Station. So that is what I did. So when the fire season was over, and imagine that you are exhausted by the nature of the fires all season, and you've been communicating between different fire parties throughout the valley and trying to take care of everybody and feeling very responsible for that lay of land because you care about it so much and you care about the people who are back there and you're doing your best and but you can't control what's going on. But so you've reached the end of your season and you've been back there in the woods essentially by yourself for 98 days. And it's time for you to leave, and you have to say goodbye to the experience, and you're getting ready to go out. So it's the end of September. 95,000 acres approximately have burnt. So I hiked up to Big Prairie after saying goodbye to the lookout and getting it boarded up. And then from there, I hiked up to Black Bear Cabin. So like the letter that I read you at first where the people from Santa Barbara got some of the rations. So I'm hiking back up there and I haven't seen it in 3 months. And I haven't seen any of these people either that I've been communicating with over the radio all season, right? So it's a very curious feeling, and I come up and I'm about to Black Bear Cabin and I hear this music, okay? I hear some music playing back behind the cabin. I was like, what the heck is this? Like, what's going on with this? And I come around and there are these firefighters. He's gorgeous. Firefighters. And they have a ukulele and they're playing some songs and they're sitting there. And I haven't seen anybody in a long time, but they're gorgeous. And they're playing me this music. And they're singing me these songs. They made me fish tacos. They thought about it ahead of time and they brought in fish. They caught some fish and they made me fish tacos, and they had made a cake. One of the guys made pineapple upside down cake. What? In the woods. And we were hanging out there in the Bob Marshall, and it was so wonderful to see some other folks and just interact with them, and they were so kind and lovely and thoughtful, and we had a really fun night kind of talking a little bit about the season and our experiences. And then the next day, this is an experience I will never forget the rest of my life, but we're all hiking out because they're all going out too for their days off, okay? So we all have to be in our fire gear because it's still very relevant that these fires are happening. So we start early, of course. We board up Black Bear Cabin. And we all get in a line and we're walking up and we're walking through. And along the way, we're encountering these different camps of firefighters who are stationed in the different areas, right? And I mean, a lot of them I had met earlier in the season during all of that training. So I was familiar with them and I've been hearing them on the radio all that time. So we're collecting people as we go along, okay? So there's like a group here, and we meet them. And we talk a little bit, and then we hike a little bit more, and then we meet another group, and then we hike a little bit more, and we meet another group. So there's this huge band of us, like this whole band of firefighters, and we're all hiking through the Bob, and let me tell you, I could not recognize that landscape for the life of me from when I hiked in. It was just black and totally charred and totally burned over. So it was just this kind of mystical, dark, eerie experience. But, you know what? I had this community of all of these lovely, amazing woodsy people with me. And I'd been alone all that time, right? So it's like, we're all hiking out together. And then we get to Meadow Creek and we're gathered around all the trucks and stuff because we're gonna drive over to the ranger station. And I was terrified. I was so scared of getting in a vehicle again. It sounds kind of silly because it wasn't that long, but it was long enough where I forgot what that was like, to be in this thing moving so quickly. And we forget that it's a thing, right? It's a thing. that we have and we use on a regular basis, but it's a thing. It's not, it doesn't have to be a thing, but anyway, that's another story. So we get into the cars and we go up to the Spotted Bear Ranger Station. We're all like this community of firefighters after this long season of burning. And I get out of the car and I'm kind of out of it. And I look over and I see my fire boss and he looks over at me and we're just like, whoa. Been talking all season on the radio. It was a great reunion, great encounter. So from here, what I'd like us to do is to get a little bit more philosophical about some things, and I'd like to hear what you all have to say and what you all have to share, and even just kind of get this on the record. But I feel like from that experience of being in the woods, and I mean, obviously I've spent other time back there, but as a lookout especially, just being back there by myself, it was really unique. And I took away a lot of things. But I wanted to pose some questions to you. And see what you think. So I have three, and we'll start off with the first one. Maybe if folks just want to kind of chime in, we can have a little bit of a discussion here at FECC with all of you woodsy folks about what's on your mind. So the first question I wanted to pose to you is, what do you think the benefits of spending wilderness time in solitude and reflection for you are personally, socially, and societally? So just take a few minutes maybe, just kind of think about that. Like, what do you think that those things are for you, yourself, and then for the other people around you? And then also for these societies that we create, and we do create them. So maybe think about that for a few minutes, and I'd like to hear if anybody wants to chime in about that. Okay, did anybody think of anything? Okay, somebody did.
Peace. Like a deep peace.
A deep peace? Yeah. Yes. You think you're across the board then? Yeah, I think so. Anybody else want to say anything? Yeah, Connor.
Solitude in the wilderness throws into sharp relief the difference between wants and needs, and you'll never see them the same again.
Yeah. So did y'all hear that? So he's saying that you really start to understand the difference between what you need and what you want. And I think that I definitely felt that way too. Yeah. Anybody else want to add anything? What are some of these benefits that we get spending time, especially in solitude? Like, what do we learn? Yes. Yeah, so she said she got back into gardening after cancer, and yeah, I think, yeah, focusing on the what's alive and what's growing is so important to the human spirit. Absolutely. Anybody else?
We're bombarded by newscasts and sound bites all the time, and when we get out into the wilderness and we have that solitude, I think we're able to make direct observations. We're not relying on other opinions and other news stations or whatever. We formulate our own opinions based on our own observations. And I think the benefit of that is that we escape from groupthink. We escape from this, having to have opinions that match everything to everyone else around us. And I think that's a benefit to us personally, socially, societally, for the groups that we form.
Yeah, I think so too. I think that feeling of being next to something that's really true too, like a tree, for example, kind of takes away everything else, and you're like, oh, here I am, and here's this tree, and there's nothing else, and it's really nice. Thank you. I think I saw another hand up here. Is there somebody else? Yeah. Yeah, I think so too. I mean, I love ice cream, for example. You know? So there are pros, and then there are some serious cons, and being able to kind of think about that for a minute and say, well, what is it that I actually value? Like, ice cream's really important, but maybe some of these other things aren't. So it's nice to be able to take that step, for sure. Okay, great. So let's move on. So I am a professor, so let's move on. Okay, this is the next question. So how might you invite more solitude and reflection into your own life? You're probably all really good at that already. Care about wilderness, but we should all think about it, maybe. Meditate. Okay, so you think, or what, say more. Yes. Yeah, I think so. I think that's the case. Yeah, we don't. Yes, we can do that. Thank you. Yes, in the back.
I think generally just like putting down the gadgets can help you have a little bit more, be able to see a bit more what's real and what's happening in front of you. Because we live in a really noisy world.
Yeah, we can get caught up with our tech stuff pretty easily, for sure. And just setting that down can be really nice. Yeah. Thank you. Anybody else have anything that you kind of thought about? Like, how are you going to do this for yourself moving forward? Why is everybody leaving?
You're going to reflect, Amy.
Okay. Okay, fine. Let's move on to the last question. Okay. So what ideas do you have for bringing wilderness perspectives and values more fully into the public sphere? So I teach public speaking here at the college, and we often talk about the public sphere and what that means. And I think it's especially relevant today. So how do we, you know, what ideas do we have for saying, okay, wilderness is so important. We know that. So what are we, what can we do? And let's, you know, let's keep it sane. We are sane people. Yes.
I say protecting the walls and grizzly, anything that has a sense of mystery in the woods.
Yeah.
Don't sterilize things. Keep things wild.
Yes. Keep it wild. Just keep it wild. Yeah. Protect our animals for sure. What other things are you thinking of? Yeah. Yeah, so every component of being in the wilderness is really important. And being it, knowing how to do that and being willing to do that is super, very important. I absolutely agree. What other things are you thinking? I know you have a lot of great thoughts, so we need to, let's bring them out. Let's talk about them. Come on. Wilderness. Yes. In the back. Yeah, take your friends, go back in the woods. Doesn't have to be by yourself, although that's cool. Yeah, go out together. I think that's a really great idea. Definitely. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, take the people that you encounter who maybe wouldn't have that opportunity otherwise to get out there. I was lucky I grew up in a family where we did go out, but some of us don't. So taking people out there who wouldn't necessarily get exposed, that's really important to you. Yes, thank you so much. Okay, awesome. Thank you for your ideas. Okay, I'm gonna leave you with a few more things and then we're about So I think, or I guess why I wanted to do this and why I wanted to speak about my experience is, has everything to do with all of the things that we've been talking about tonight. And my passion for the wilderness is the deepest thing about me and the most important thing about me. And I know that a lot of you also feel that way yourselves. But everything that I feel like the things that I've learned the most and that are the most valuable have come from my spending that time out there and learning about myself and also, yes, in reflection to society when you re-enter that realm and kind of having that look back on what everything means. So that passion is something that is deep within my heart and that is the reason that I do what I do and live the way that I live. And I'm so proud to be who I am, and I'm so proud to be from Montana, and I'm so proud of all of our public lands here, and I would encourage all of you to keep working towards that in any capacity that you can. Okay, so I'm gonna leave you with a last quote by Lookout Extraordinaire Ed Abbey. May your trails be crooked, winding, and lonesome, and dangerous, and leading to the most amazing view, where storms come and go, and lightning clangs upon the high crags, or something strange and more beautiful and more full of wonder than your deepest dreams. All right. Well, we got plenty of time. If you had questions you wanted to ask, there's also a microphone. Also, some other people are getting up to go, that's fine. But you should, my final call into you is to donate or join one of these foundations, the Bob Marshall Wilderness Foundation, the Montana Wilderness, baby crying, Montana Wilderness Association, or the Northwest Montana Fire Lookout Association. Donate or join to these organizations because they are working towards public lands and public issues, and they are really important in our community. You're probably all part of them already, but I'm just telling you that anyway. And then opening it up to questions. Is there anybody who had something that you wanted to ask? What? Yes, in fact, I got invited to yesterday. Yes, I will do it again. It's great. Great. Probably a different place. Just to get a different lay of land. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
I understood you were going to Pole Bridge this summer, but are you still doing that? And if you are,
oh, so you read that article. I have a couple different options going on. So I'm thinking about a lookout, and I'm also thinking about Pole Ridge. I think Pole Ridge would be great. There's a lot great community of artists up there. Maybe a fantastic experience. And I'd probably bartend if I went up there. See you at the Northern Lights. Any other questions? Yes!
What was your favorite meal to cook in the lookout?
I cooked a bunch of different types of stuff. Sometimes it was kind of fancy, surprisingly. You know, I'd find a pad Thai, do-yourself meal in Mugata. So I had like Thai food back there, and that was really nice. And also, my staple is eggs, cheese and eggs. Yum. Yeah. Yeah, I've most extensively hiked in Montana, but I've hiked in California and Arizona quite a bit, and a little bit in Japan and India. Yeah.
I wanted to hear more about this old moose that you talked about.
What do you want to know about that moose? I don't know if there's any more to say except for that, yeah, the old moose came up and I watched him and I was confused by that because there was nowhere to go. And then he just hung out for a while and then went right back down the exact same way, and I just smiled at him. He was old. Yeah.
So you said it was eerie, and I agree with you because when I'm out in the woods and I go too far and then I end up walking back in the dark, I'm scared entirely. So when you were out in the dark like that by yourself, usually I'm with the hunting buddy, how did you not lose your mind? Mountain lions, bears, that kind of stuff? Did you tie something to your belt, make noise?
Yeah, thank you for understanding that feeling. It can be really overwhelming. Yeah, absolutely. Good question, Logan. Extra credit.
Yes! That's why I pay.
But to get back to the actual question, how did I not lose my mind? I think a lot of it was just, I don't know. How did I not lose my mind? I don't know. Looking back on it, I have no idea. But I just kind of got in the rhythm of the day. And then when the night would come, you look at the sky. And I had lots of very strange experiences. But I think writing, actually writing, that's the answer. Writing helped me a lot because I could come back to that and I could say, I saw this weird thing. And then at least I was, you know, documenting it somehow. And that gave me a sense of ease. Yeah.
I'm just wondering about, were there any habits or realizations or values, really anything that you've taken back with you from the lookout and put into your life now?
Yeah, I think so many things. I think the notion that what you have is enough, I think that's always important. And that everything is okay all the time. Like, maybe at this moment I feel kind of freaked out by something, but that'll pass. Like, everything will pass. And just kind of sitting into that a little bit and sort of saying, well, yeah, that overarching trust that it's all good. And not in a nonchalant way, like, oh, I don't care about my life, but in the sense of that I don't need to have anxiety over things I can't control. So thank you for asking. Yeah, I think I got resupplied once. It was a really busy summer with the fire, so everybody got pulled off of their normal work in order to fight the fires. So, but yeah, I got resupplied once by the packers from Big Prairie, and they brought up food for me, and that was really nice. And then I also would backpack up food from Big Prairie myself. So I definitely, you know, I had access to food. For sure, and I wasn't gonna starve, and they certainly weren't going to let me starve. No, no way, no way. They're too good. They're too good of people. Yeah, water was really similarly done because the lookout at Jumbo is pretty far from a water source. It's about 4 or 5 miles, so, and it's steep, so packing it up was really difficult, but there was tons of water up there that they had packed in earlier from different excursions of the mules that the packers had brought up. But yeah, I rationed it very carefully. I think more experienced lookouts know how to do it a lot better than I did because they understand what to use, but I didn't know, so I just was very scarce about it. You know, like I would drink my coffee and I'd be like, no more water the rest of the day. But yeah, I'm fine. Yeah, Jumbo was spectacular. They have a solar panel system up there, so I had energy through that source, so I could, I figured out, like, the last couple weeks, I had a light that I could plug in at night, which, that was so amazing. But yeah, they had that capacity up there, so I could charge my radios and everything else that way, and it's really nice, actually, up there. And every lookout's a little bit different, but fancy.
All right, I think everybody who really wanted to go home has left, so if you want to stay and ask more questions, I'm going to let you come and talk directly to Amy, but right now we'd like to thank her for being our speaker, and we have a gift for her. Just a couple of wilderness announcements. If you'd like your own 20 Years of Love for the Bob t-shirts, we're selling for $10 tonight, right out there. Couple other announcements. On March 9th in Whitefish is Telluride Mountain Film on Tour. It's a fundraiser to keep trails open in the Bob. Doors open at 6, films at 7. And if you are like me and you need a reminder on your refrigerator door, there are little flyers just outside, just beyond Bob Marshall, that you can take home and put on your refrigerator. At the beginning of the talk, I mentioned that this presentation was offered by all of the organizations in the Valley who provide stewardship and voice for wilderness. And right now, John from MWA would like to talk about some of their initiatives.
Yeah, Amy, thank you. I met Amy a few months ago, and about 2 minutes into it, I realized that her presentation was going to be fantastic, because unlike me, it wasn't just a PowerPoint with, you know, bullet points. But that was really, it was so natural, so genuine, so real. It's my idea of meditation now is to listen to stories that, you know, as you deliver them. So that was, it was really fantastic. But as Amy said at the end, if there are three organizations out there, MWA, Bob Marshall, and the Northwest Montana Forest Fire Lookout Association, all three of them have a sign-up sheet. It's, you know, one of the things we do to reach out is to, you know, all three of the organizations sponsor either this speaker series.